Well, hello again, everyone. Park Ranger Joel Kane here one last time for the final day of the virtual Grand Canyon GeoFest 2020. Those of you who have been tuning in over the course of the week, I hope you've enjoyed all of the amazing talks that we've had over the week. And we've got a couple more lined up here for you today on the final day of GeoFest. Now, Grand Canyon National Park is an incredible place. Everywhere in Grand Canyon is amazing in its own way, but there are some places in Grand Canyon that are just pure magic, and I'm in one of those places right now. I'm at a place called Indian Garden, about halfway down the Bright Angel Trail, 3,000 feet below the south rim of Grand Canyon. And this is truly an incredible place. As you can see around me, there's tons of greenery, plant life. There are tall trees casting welcoming shade that hikers just love down here in the depths of Grand Canyon, especially in the summer. And of course, the most important thing, the reason we have all of these plants and trees here, water. And a couple of our talks today are actually going to be all about water. But our first talk is actually about that idea of place. What is a place exactly? Is it just a location on a map? Is it just a geographical location, or is it something more? And as you'll see in our first talk, well, it is something more. The idea of place actually has to do with human connections and history and culture. And that's a bit of what we're going to be talking about here today. Because we've been talking about geologic time over the course of the week, geologic processes operating over hundreds of millions or even billions of years. So we've talked a lot about things that happened a very, very long time ago in Earth history to create this incredible landscape that we call Grand Canyon. But today on the final day of GeoFest, we're going to bring it back to the here and now and talk about Grand Canyon as a place with human connections, both today and going back thousands of years. The name Indian Garden comes from the fact that native peoples living in this part of the world have been living in places like this here in Grand Canyon for at least 13,000 years that we know of, maybe longer. And of course, in a desert, anywhere with water is going to be an incredibly important place to anyone living in that region, even today. Even today, we depend on water. And getting water to everyone who comes to visit Grand Canyon is no easy task. We'll talk a little bit about that over the course of the talks today. So that's mainly what we're going to be focusing on here today, the final day of GeoFest, Grand Canyon as a place with human connections going back thousands of years. How do we understand this landscape in that context? And also looking at some geologic processes that are happening now, today. The movement of water through the rocks of Grand Canyon has profound implications for the people who come to visit here, the people who decide to hike down the Bright Angel Trail into Grand Canyon. This creek makes them very, very happy, I assure you. Now, this is one of the few perennial creeks in Grand Canyon, meaning one of the few creeks that's flowing year-round. Grand Canyon is full of little creeks and springs and seeps, as we'll soon learn, but most of them do not flow all year-round. This one actually does. This is Garden Creek. Springs up at Indian Garden actually form this creek, which then flows the whole way down to the Colorado River. And that makes this Indian Garden a pretty incredible place. So I hope you enjoy our first talk on that sense of place, and then the talks to follow on water in Grand Canyon, specifically groundwater from hydrothermal springs coming up from below, and also freshwater springs fed from rain and snow coming down from above, and how those water systems connect to people here at Grand Canyon. Thanks for joining us this week and today for the final day of GeoFest. Once again, I'm Joel Kane. Thanks for being here. And it has been an honor and a pleasure to host this event over the course of this week. And I hope you've enjoyed watching these talks as much as I've enjoyed hosting them. Well, hello everyone, and welcome to the final day of talks here for the week of Earth Science Week, or Grand Canyon
Geology Festival, or GeoFest 2020. We've been talking a lot this week about, of course, the geology of Grand Canyon, the different rocks that are found there in the canyon, how the canyon formed. Today we thought we'd wrap things up, kind of bringing this back to the here and now. One thing we're going to be talking a lot about later on is water, kind of the lifeblood of Grand Canyon. But starting us off today, we're going to be talking about place, kind of how a sense of place can help us learn, can kind of learn about the geology of Grand Canyon. Here to talk with us about those perspectives is Stephen Semken, who's a professor of geology and education in the School of Earth and Space Exploration at Arizona State University. He's an ethnogeologist who studies the geological knowledge of different cultures in their homelands, and also a geoscience education researcher who studies new and effective approaches to teaching earth science to students and the public. He and his students work in the American Southwest and Latin America, with particular attention to indigenous and Hispanic Latinx communities. Before coming to ASU, he taught 15 years on the Navajo Nation, which of course borders Grand Canyon National Park directly to the east. And Semken was part of the team that designed and created the Trail of Time exhibition right here at Grand Canyon National Park. He's a fellow of the Geological Society of America and won multiple awards for university and college teaching. Thank you very much for being with us here today, Dr. Semken. Yeah, thank you, absolutely.
Okay, shall we start?
If you're ready to go, let's dive in.
All right, let's do that. So hopefully you can you see the slide?
Oh, yep, we're good. Yeah, we're
okay.
All good.
Well, thank you very much for having me, Joel. I'm really glad to be here. I'm a tremendous lover of Grand Canyon and all of that Grand Canyon represents. And as you mentioned, I'm a geologist by training, but I'm also a teacher of geology. And most of my research is on how we can teach geology in the most effective way and also hear from all of the different voices that make up the Grand Canyon, all of the different groups and all the different peoples who call Grand Canyon important or who call it home. So I'm going to talk for a little bit about place-based education and interpretation at Grand Canyon, which is a work I've been doing for a number of years. Let's start out with this idea of what a place is. There are lots of different definitions of the word place, but I like to use the term that geographers use. And geographers are say that a place is a location that is given meaning through human experience. By living there, by earning a living there, by having a ceremonial uses there, by studying it scientifically, by studying it historically, all the different ways that we interact with physical locations on the earth, or even imaginary locations, we give them meaning, and that becomes what makes them into places. So Grand Canyon is a great example of a place because it's been given a myriad of meanings through human experience. If you think about all the different meanings that people have affixed to Grand Canyon over many, many, many centuries of human habitation there, we see it as a beautiful place, an alluring place, a storied landscape that provides us with knowledge, geological and human. It is, of course, the homeland to more than 12 indigenous communities and still very culturally important, so it's a Native American homeland. It is scientifically significant because of the enormous window into Earth history that it provides. Almost 2 billion years of Earth's history is encoded in the rocks that we see in Grand Canyon and by the processes that form Grand Canyon. And then the interpretation of that scientific knowledge, the interpretation of the data we get from studying the rocks adds to the meanings. There's human history of indigenous people and human history of other groups that came later. Tremendous educational value. The National Park Service has a mission to interpret Grand Canyon for generations to come, and so people come and learn the scientific and the cultural history of Grand Canyon. Also great recreational value. Rafting, hiking, camping, all of the different ways that people enjoy landscapes. And of course, it's also controversial in some ways because there are disputes over how that land is to be used. We talk about meanings in places being negotiated by different people. Different groups kind of come together and they say, well, here are the meanings that we are going to agree upon are the most significant. And that's a constant process of discussion and debate. And so there have been disputes over the use of the land and whether or not, for example, mining should be allowed in the vicinity of the canyon. So all of these are meanings that contribute to making Grand Canyon a place. And I like to think of places as part of what's called a cultural landscape. Geographers like Carl Sauer, and you can see the quote here, Carl Sauer was a geographer at the University of California in the early 20th century. Geographers, as well as many other people who know land, including many, many indigenous cultures, they cannot separate humans from the landscape. So there's a natural landscape that's created by geological and other natural processes. The Grand Canyon is a great natural landscape with landforms and the Colorado River system and the ecosystems associated with it. But human beings, by establishing places on the landscape, they actually create what we know as a cultural landscape. And the cultural landscape is interwoven intimately with the natural landscape because there's really nowhere on Earth that human beings have not either set foot or at least looked at or at least thought about. And that's certainly true of Grand Canyon. So places are human constructs in the natural landscape, and they constitute themselves what we would call a cultural landscape. And as a geoscientist, we talk all the time about landforms. We talk about mesas and buttes and canyons and alluvial fans and all of the physical features on the surface of the Earth that are created by geological processes. Well, places are the cultural equivalents. These are features in the cultural landscape that are created by human beings, or made by human beings when we give meaning to location. And the reason why I got interested in place is because I'm a geoscientist, and place is very important to all natural sciences and certainly the geosciences, because the very act of studying nature on the Earth's surface, in Earth environments, even remotely by, you know, using instruments to study the Earth, we're making the Earth a place. We do it through places. When we start to study a particular location, we're affixing meaning to that place, and so it becomes a place. And that's whether we do it on the ground, like on the left there, you know, we're actually at Grand Canyon looking at the geology, or even remotely. We can virtually visit many aspects, many places around Grand Canyon now and study them online as well as in person. But either way we do that, we are affixing meaning to those places through the scientific study. And in turn, the scientific knowledge that we get from our studies adds to the meanings of places. I mean, certainly a considerable amount of the meaning that's associated with Grand Canyon has come from the geological research that has been carried out there by many generations of Earth scientists. And the thing, though, is that if you think about place, I mean, place is something that we all understand sort of intuitively. We all make places because we affix meanings to those locations that are important to us. I mean, for example, people who love Grand Canyon, they have their own personal meanings that they establish by going there. They may be emotional, they may be practical, they may be scientific, but we all sort of affix meanings to places. And in the process of doing that, we as human beings tend to form emotional attachments to those same places. I love Grand Canyon. People love Grand Canyon. There's an emotional attachment that's there that's part of what we affix when we interact with the place. And geographers and psychologists have a concept that we call the sense of place. And the sense of place is literally defined as the combination of those meanings and those attachments that we all form. So we, each individual, and also people in a group, will tend to have a set of meanings that they've established. You know, the Grand Canyon, for example, is scientifically interesting. It's aesthetically beautiful. It's important to indigenous people. This is all the different meanings. And then, you know, we also affix these emotional attachments. We care about it. We want to act to benefit it. We want to act to help sustain it, help preserve it. And so these attachments together with the meanings are what we call sense of place. And what's important about sense of place is that if we understand what sense of place is, then we can teach, or we can interpret, or we can act in such a way to benefit that place. okay, to understand that place. And also, the other really interesting thing about sense of place is that we can actually define it and measure it. I mean, we can actually sort of measure people's sense of place, either by asking them questions on a survey or just watching how they interact with the place, how they interact with it, how they understand it, how they learn from it, how they show their emotional attachments. All of these are sort of indicative of the sense of place that people have for an important place like Grand Canyon. So one way that we can channel or we can leverage sense of place in a way to teach people geoscience or teach other fields that are related to that place is what we call place-based teaching. And place-based teaching is a form of teaching where we explicitly engage not only with, if we're teaching natural science, let's say, we don't just engage with the natural landscapes, we also engage with the cultural landscapes. We try to infuse the knowledge that's affixed to that place that is scientifically relevant, but also the culturally relevant knowledge is context for the scientific. In other words, it becomes more important and more meaningful to teach about the science when we understand what the cultural context of that sciences in that particular place. And so and I'm going to talk a little bit about how we actually do that, but place-based teaching is a kind of teaching that sort of deliberately tries to encourage people to form and to strengthen a sense of place in whatever the places they're studying, like, for example, the Colorado Plateau, as you see here. And my area of research is mostly studying how this particular approach to teaching works and how we can do it better. And research that I've done and research that other of my colleagues have done has shown that when we teach in a place-based way, we can make science, geoscience or ecology or any branch of the natural sciences, more relevant and more engaging to more different kinds of students, including students from historically underserved groups who may not have been served as well by the educational system that puts people in a schoolroom, let's say. Place-based teaching also fosters pro-environmental and pro-social attitudes and behaviors. When people's senses of place are made stronger through place-based teaching, they tend to think and act in ways that help preserve the integrity of the place they study, like, for example, Grand Canyon. And so it does tend to foster care for and stewardship of natural landscapes and parks like Grand Canyon. The other thing is that sense of place connects place-based teaching. And when we think of place-based teaching, we usually apply that in the sense of what we might call formal education, which is done in terms of a class, whether it's a K through 12 class or a college class. But there's this whole other realm, of course, that you know well, called interpretation. Interpretation is the form of place-based education that is native to the National Park Service. It's the way that interpretive rangers help people to make emotional and intellectual connections with the place they're visiting. And this is a definition after the National Association for Interpretation. But again, if you look at that definition of interpretation, intended to form emotional and intellectual connections, that's sense of place. And so sense of place connects maybe formal teaching that we might do in a geology class or a high school science class or college geology class with the kind of informal science education that rangers and other interpreters do at Grand Canyon National Park and all the national parks every day. So it kind of brings these two forms of teaching and learning, which are very similar, together over this idea of sense of place. So how do we do it? Again, we've done a great deal of research. We've studied how people have taught sense of place, evoking sense of place taught in a place-based way over the years. And we've come up with this model of sort of five ideas. So if you wanted to teach or interpret in a place-based way, this is kind of the recipe that might work for you. And five components here. We use the five fingers of a hand to symbolize those. First, you for content, you focus on natural landscapes and natural phenomena. For example, if it's the Grand Canyon, you focus on the geology and the ecology and the hydrology of Grand Canyon. And then you meaningfully integrate local cultural landscapes and knowledge for context. And here's where other forms of knowledge that are related to the place are brought to bear, like indigenous knowledge and local knowledge and history and art. I mean, you can bring art, the way that people represent Grand Canyon artistically can also be used. teach by authentic experiences, and that used to mean pretty much exclusively going out into the field and engaging with the place physically, and that's still the preferred way, but it's not always accessible to everybody, and luckily we now have improved technology that allows us to explore many landscapes like Grand Canyon virtually online. And so that opens it to a much wider audience and a more diverse audience. In teaching in a place-based way, you want to encourage both practices and policies that favor natural and cultural sustainability. If we're going to teach about Grand Canyon, we want to do it in a way where people understand that we have to act continually to help preserve the natural and the cultural integrity of a place like Grand Canyon. And then finally, the fifth attribute of place-based teaching is to guide learners to form their own sense of place, to form intellectual and emotional connections, again, which is something that interpretive rangers do. It's something that place-based teachers do as well. And if you do any one of these five things, either as a teacher or you're doing it as a learner, then you're along the path to place-based education. Now, at Grand Canyon, if we want to teach in a place-based way, we're very fortunate because we have 2 billion years of Earth's history preserved in the geology, encoded in the geology, along with many millennia of human history and culture. And these two sets of histories are richly interwoven in the land, and we have a lot of wonderful things that we can understand and we can teach about to use in a place-based way if we're going to teach about Grand Canyon. I think that our Trail of Time exhibition, which is 10 years old this year, does a good job of integrating these two schools, these natural and cultural. It's designed as a walking time trail to teach the geology of Grand Canyon and the Colorado Plateau and to teach basic principles of geology, geologic time and geologic change. But we also provide a lot of cultural context. We talk about indigenous people at Grand Canyon. We talk about events that have affected human history. We talk about climate change, which is affecting people even today. So we did try to integrate both of these two realms, both the scientific, natural scientific, and the social science or the cultural when we designed the Trail of Time. If we were to continue to teach in a place-based way, we have lots of different things we could talk about. I mean, Grand Canyon, the Colorado River is part of this enormous surface water system that is essentially the lifeblood of the Southwest, but it's also the lifeblood of all the different ecosystems that have evolved and exist along the courses of the rivers. So there are topics like groundwater and surface water and uranium mining and climate and all kinds of different scientific topics that we can talk about if we want to focus on a place-based approach to understanding Grand Canyon. My research, as you mentioned, is what we call ethnogeology. And ethnogeology, we do this research so we can inform place-based geoscience teaching, finding out knowledge that we can then apply in place-based teaching. And ethnogeology is the scientific study of human relationships with and knowledge of the earth. So it's done within, with permission from, and in collaboration with specific cultures or communities. So one example would be an indigenous community that lives in or around Grand Canyon, how they have learned to understand how natural systems in Grand Canyon works, how to interpret the geology in their own cultural framework. That's what we are most interested in. So ethnogeology is kind of a combination of field ethnography and field geology. And as a geologist, I was trained as a geologist, not as an ethnographer, but I've had the very good fortune to work with not only ethnographers, but also with wonderful indigenous scholars who've been very generous about sharing their ethnogeological knowledge of places like Grand Canyon. So there are the 12 traditionally associated tribes of Grand Canyon, as well as many other indigenous communities in the surrounding area. And all of them have important knowledge about natural systems in the Grand Canyon, their own understanding of geological processes, their own understanding of hydrological processes and ecology, and their ways of living on the landscape. Many of which are, of course, presented in their own indigenous languages. And there's a lot that could be worked with. I think it's very important that we find ways to enable or to facilitate that these communities share the knowledge that they most want people to understand. They want visitors to Grand Canyon to understand that this is a homeland of these indigenous people for a long, long time, and that this knowledge in the most appropriate way should be part of what is presented to visitors at Grand Canyon. And my good fortune of teaching 15 years on the Navajo or Diné Nation allowed me to capture a little bit of a glimpse of what we might call Diné ethnogeology. And so again, working with colleagues like my former student Al Blackhorse and my good friend and colleague Perry Charlie, we were able to study and to document traditional Diné or Navajo geological knowledge of the Colorado Plateau and Grand Canyon. Terminology and place names that abundantly characterize landmarks and rocks and landforms, but also terms used to describe the actual natural processes that shape the landscape, both the processes that act from below to cause uplift and to cause mountain building and to cause volcanic activity, as well as the processes that act from above that create weathering and erosion and shaping of the landscape into what we recognize as the distinctive landscapes of the Colorado Plateau and the Grand Canyon. And there are terms for all of these, there are concepts for all of these that can be translated into the Navajo language or exist in the Navajo language. And so we can teach these ideas from these two parallel perspectives. And we even have found ways that we can talk about how the canyon was formed in both cultural worldviews, because both on the Diné side and on what we might call the Western geoscience side, there are explanations for how the canyon was formed, and they're remarkably parallel. The Navajo worldview talks about Yedidlif, Father Sky, and Nahastan, Mother Earth, as two dynamic systems that interact through natural processes to create the landscape around the Diné people, the homeland of the Diné people, which of course borders on Grand Canyon. And we find parallels in those indigenous scientific ideas in mainstream geoscience, where we talk about geodynamic processes, which are the processes that act from within the earth to bring about the origin of rocks, to bring about volcanoes, to bring about plate tectonics and tectonic shaping, and the geomorphic processes that are acting from above to carve the canyon and to shape the landscapes and to widen the canyon through mass movement and so on. And so we can actually account for these two worldviews, and we can give credence to these two worldviews when we talk about the geology of the Colorado Plateau. And I would like to very much see this same sort of thing done with the permission, of course, of other indigenous communities that live on or near the Grand Canyon. We also have now been working on ways that we can impart this same sense of place to the virtual realm. So we've created virtual field trips of the Grand Canyon with the support of the Park Service and the funding from the National Science Foundation. And that URL that shows down there, you can find a online field trip, virtual field trip to Grand Canyon that's free to all to explore anytime they want to. And they can, people who use it can explore pretty much the entire 277 mile length of the canyon, as well as other places. So I'll just conclude by saying that I'd certainly like to encourage increasing collaboration between the national park, the tribal communities, and other communities to learn more about ethnogeological knowledge from different cultural perspectives, to learn more about place names, to learn more about languages that explain the landscape and explain both the cultural and natural landscapes. And these can be integrated into the interpretive resources and programs of the park to enhance the place-based nature of future teaching and interpretation. And I'll stop there and I'll say thank you very much, or Acheha in the Navajo language, and gracias. Thanks, Joel. That was probably, way too long, wasn't it?
Oh, no, that's fine. Oh, totally fine. No, thank you. Thank you.
Okay.
Very much for that, yeah. I'm going to go back to this view. You know, it's amazing. It was amazing watching, you know, or listening to your talk there, and seeing there's actually a lot of parallels. So I've been doing a talk here at the Canyon for the past 5 years, an evening program that I call Shifting Perspectives.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, I did my very first year working here at the Canyon. I put it together. I had up until that point only really been focusing on geology programs. And this one I decided I need to branch out and broaden my horizons and try something different. And I talk about geology in this program, but it's mostly about historical perspectives on the canyon. Mm-hmm. And at the start of it, I asked this question of everybody, and I asked them to think about what is Grand Canyon? And I tell them, you know, it's not just a giant hole in the ground, you know, right, with a river down there at the bottom. It's a concept that humans attach meanings to.
It's a place.
Exactly. It's a place.
It's a place. Yep.
And I do talk about geology a little bit in there as understanding it, you know, through geology. But I talk about a lot of other concepts too, like you mentioned art.
Yep.
You know, I talk a little bit about how it's been interpreted artistically.
I would have brought that in too.
So it was really, really, really awesome to see your talk about this, because it's something that I've been talking about in a little bit, kind of in my own way, for the past couple of years.
Well, you know, I've always admired what you guys do as far as inter at the park and all the different ideas that you bring in. So, and I did actually go and get trained as an interpretive guide just because I was fascinated by the whole world of interpretation. And so, you know, it's mutual. I've learned a great deal from interacting with park staff and also just reading up on interpretation. It does inform what I've been doing with place-based ed. So.
Yeah, great. Yeah. And kind of the conclusion of the talk I do, not to give it away if anybody wants to come and see it sometime, but, when we're actually giving in-person programs again, the dramatic conclusion is that I can't tell people what Grand Canyon is, that it's something we all have to kind of come to ourselves, an idea that we have to develop ourselves. And then I like to say that in a way, there's a new Grand Canyon being created like every single day.
Exactly. Yeah. Place meanings are changing all the time. Yeah. Places are just as dynamic as the, you know, anything in the natural landscape, and you're absolutely right. So,
and of course we've been talking this whole week about, about the science of Grand Canyon, the geology of it, of how it was formed and how the rocks got there and all that. But you know, in the end, it's nice to come back to the question of kind of, well, why does any of this matter? You know, why do we care about something that happened a billion years ago? And then we got into a little bit the other day with Dr. James Hagedorn about
why the Hagedorn?
Yeah.
Yeah, I know. He's a good man. Yeah, he's a great man.
Oh yeah.
I bet he gave you a great talk, because he's so dynamic. Oh my gosh, he's dynamic.
Yeah, fantastic speaker. Yeah.
Yeah.
But we kind of came back to, you know, it's like, well, why does this matter today? And I like to always throw out that classic, you know, idea in geology that the present is the key to the past. But then I bring it back around. It's like, well, the past is also the key to the present. Understanding the past is a way of understanding, you know, why things are the way they are now, how they got this way, and maybe even predicting how they, you know, what might happen in the future. So I really, really appreciate that kind of perspective here at the end of the last day here of the Geology Festival. And the Trail of Time is one of my favorite things here at the park, by the way.
Thank you. Well, it was really Carl's brainstorm, but I was so glad that he invited me to participate, because it was the most fun project I've ever been a part of.
Yeah.
It was just that every time we could go up there to work on it, it was just, I couldn't wait. I couldn't wait to get back up there. I mean, I love Grand Canyon and I live pretty close, but you know, I try to get up a couple times a year, but I can never be up there enough. I do love Grand Canyon so much.
Oh yeah. So, and I love it here too. Something I found after being here for a little over 5 years now, is that the more I learn about Grand Canyon, and the deeper my understanding of it becomes, the more meaningful it becomes.
Yes.
And, you know, I you could spend a lifetime here and still be learning about this place and kind of developing that concept in your mind of what it is and what it means and what it represents.
Yeah. I'll never forget the time I got to hike up to what's behind you there and look at those and look at those granaries. Oh. You know, I'd seen pictures of them for years, and then when I finally got to go there myself, I could just, my heart was just so full. Like, oh my gosh, this is so special. And the view from up there that you've got, I mean, it's just, yeah.
Yeah.
Being able to go down the river a couple times with Carl and Lori was an eye-opening experience and a life-changing experience. So.
Oh, I know the feeling. I unfortunately, I haven't had the chance to get to this spot myself yet. The Nankweep Trail, that's one on my, I have, a list of things I really want to do, and that's on there. You know, but every time I hike down a new trail, I get to a new place that I've been wanting to go for a long time. I experience that same sort of feeling.
That's wonderful. That's really wonderful.
So yeah, I really look forward to getting up in this area here and seeing these at some point myself too. So.
It's really neat. It's really neat. I only got to go once. This next time we went down, we just went by and waved at it as we went by. But we did get to go one time. We camped out at Nankweep for a couple of days for field work, and it was great. So.
Oh man. Well, thank you very, very much for for talking with us here today.
I hope this is something that you can use. All right. Well, thank you.
Of course. Thanks for being here. Appreciate it.
Hello again, everyone. I certainly enjoyed that last talk, and I hope you all did as well. I'll tell you, the longer I spend here at Grand Canyon, the more I understand this place, the more I learn, the more I have started thinking of it as a place, not just a location or a geologic wonder, but a place with human connections and a concept with different meanings attached to it. And in thinking of Grand Canyon as a place, our next two talks are going to be about something that's very important to both Grand Canyon and to people, water. Two different types of water, as a matter of fact. Hydrothermal fluids coming up to the surface from deep underneath inside the earth, and fresh water coming down from above from rain and snow feeding springs in the canyon. And our first talk is going to be focusing on those hydrothermal fluids coming up from underneath. Now, these fluids are coming out in some of the most beautiful places in Grand Canyon, places like the Little Colorado River Confluence, Havasu Falls, Ribbon Falls. Unfortunately, those places were a little bit outside my abilities to whisk us away to different locations, which is why I'm standing here at the first portal on the Trail of Time. Some of you might remember that these portals feature rocks from Grand Canyon of different ages. And since this is the very first one, these are some of the youngest rocks in Grand Canyon, like the ones I'm standing on here. Where these hydrothermal fluids are coming up to the surface, they are forming a mineral called travertine. Now, some of you might actually have cut and polished countertops of travertine in your home. And the rocks I'm standing on, some of these really beautiful cut rocks back behind me here, this is travertine from Grand Canyon. It's only forming in a few places in the canyon, which we're going to learn a lot more about here in our next talk about those hydrothermal fluids and this beautiful mineral travertine that's being formed at different places in the canyon. So I hope you enjoy that talk, and then the talk afterwards, of course, about freshwater springs. Thanks for joining us.
Well, hello, everybody. We are here today with Dr. Laura Crossey, professor of geology at the University of New Mexico. Her research interests include low temperature geochemistry, including diagenesis, hydrochemistry, and geomicrobiology. Her research approach emphasizes interdisciplinary field research with ongoing projects in Grand Canyon, the Rocky Mountains, southwestern United States, Simpson Desert of the Australian Outback, and the Western Desert of Egypt. With Dr. Carl Karlstrom, she led design and installation of the Trail of Time geoscience exhibition here at Grand Canyon National Park. And she's been researching Grand Canyon geology since 1995, with emphasis on the Chuar group and travertines, which are the youngest rocks in Grand Canyon, and the hydrology and gas chemistry of the Grand Canyon's groundwater systems. She's directed 40 master's and PhDs in her 35 years as a professor. So joining us here today to talk about water in Grand Canyon, Dr. Laura Crossey, thank you so much for being here.
Great, thanks for having me, Joel. Are you ready to get going and get wet?
Absolutely, yeah. As you can see, I'm here. Not really, but I'm here at Elves Chasm, deep within Grand Canyon. Which, to be honest, sadly, unfortunately, it's not a place I've had the opportunity to visit yet. It's on my list. Places I'd like to go.
You'll see later. That's one of the springs that we've gone in and sampled. So let me share my presentation with you and the group, and hopefully you can see all that.
Yeah, absolutely.
Terrific. Thanks, Joel. So I'll be taking you to some of the most spectacular locations in Grand Canyon. This work that I've been doing over many years involves a lot of different collaborators, both within UNM and elsewhere, and also, of course, graduate students past and present. Shown in this glorious photograph by Grand Canyon photographer Gary Ladd is Vasey's Paradise, one of the most spectacular springs in the Grand Canyon, right down near the river, showing the beautiful groundwater pouring out across the landscape. So let's go in and learn a little more about springs. One of the important aspects of the springs and groundwater is, of course, they sustain amazing ecosystems in the arid Southwest. Secondly, of course, this water, the water coming from the springs, is used for human consumption. Thirdly, these springs and the beautiful travertine deposits are of great cultural importance to many of the tribes that call Grand Canyon their home. Last but not least, these springs and the groundwater systems that sustain them are threatened by mining and development across the Colorado Plateau region. So by studying the springs, we can understand better their sustainability and things that are going to impact the water quality. Throughout the week, you've been looking at some of the amazing stories told by Grand Canyon rocks. Here's a view from Lippin Point at the spectacular exposures of geology. But in addition to the rocks, what we've done is we've dissected a fantastic aquifer system, a world-class aquifer system. So Grand Canyon offers the chance not just to learn about the rocks and the stories they tell, but to go in and sample springs emerging in various places in the canyon and along the Colorado River to understand what's happening in the subterranean groundwater systems. Shown here is an aerial view of the confluence of the Colorado River, which is green in color, running from left to right across the slide, and the Little Colorado River, shown in beautiful bright blue, sourced from a spring many miles up that side canyon. We can tell from the color that these two are two very different waters. In a way, the Colorado River is a visitor to the Grand Canyon region, flowing from the high Rockies down through the Grand Canyon and on its way out west. On the other hand, the Little Colorado River is a spring-fed system, like all the side streams of the Grand Canyon region, formed from groundwaters emerging from the subsurface. It's pretty obvious to us here that we can see on the surface these two different water types mixing because the colors provide that evidence. If we zoom up a little closer, now I'm standing at the confluence with the Little Colorado River coming in to the left with the beautiful turquoise waters and the green Colorado River flowing from right to left across the photograph. And we can see a mixing zone as these two waters meet together and mingle in the river. But what about in the subsurface? What if we have groundwater mixing in the subsurface? We don't have this visual sort of evidence. So we have to use other tools and tracers of water, and that's going to be the focus of my talk today. We have aquifer units that are obviously important for groundwater, and shown here is a schematic view of the stratigraphy, those flat-lying layers of Grand Canyon, from the perspective of hydrology. The main aquifer units, that is the water-bearing units right in the Grand Canyon corridor, is called the RM aquifer, for Redwall Muav Aquifer, a combination of these two units that are both karst aquifers, that is limestone units that have incredible porosity and permeability from caves, from faults and fractures that have been widened by the long action of the water moving through these aquifers. Another important part of the system is the confining unit beneath. That's the Bright Angel Shale shown here. and it serves as a base. And so the waters get trapped after they infiltrate and they emerge in the canyon most from the Redwall Muav Aquifer. There are some other springs from other units, but this is the main aquifer that hosts these springs. This cartoon also indicates this conceptual idea that we have recharge from rain and snow up in the landscape around the Grand Canyon region. That water infiltrates through, finding its way into the RM aquifer, and is then carried to the canyon where it emerges as a spring. This is a fairly simplistic view, and we're going to look at the complexities that probably are also important to understand the water quality and the differences in the different types of spring waters. We're going to look at natural tracers. These are things that are in the water that help us understand mixing and the hydrologic flow paths in the subterranean regions. In the picture, we see Carl Carlstrom and former student Dennis Newell collecting bubbles from a spring in Grand Canyon using a funnel and a glass. And so this is one way that we trap gases, which is one type of a tracer that I'll be talking about today. Secondly, we're going to use the solutes in the water, that is the salts that are in the water. And third, we'll look at the stable isotopes of the water molecule itself. So these are the three types of geochemical evidence that I'm going to focus on today. We've sampled over many years springs and side streams throughout the Grand Canyon region. Shown here is a map with the Colorado River flowing from the upper right, around the corner, down here across the Bright Angel Fault, further west, all the way past Lava, and out past Pumpkin Spring, Travertine Grotto, the Western Grand Canyon, and all the way out past the Grand Wash Cliffs. Back here is the confluence of the Little Colorado River and the Colorado River that we looked at before. And the dots here represent different sampling points, some we've returned to multiple times, where we've gotten stable isotope samples, water samples for geochemical analysis, and also some of our gas sampling sites. So it's on this basis over many years that I'm going to summarize some of our important findings. One thing we noticed right away is that we have different types of spring waters. I'm going to euphemistically refer to the first type as upper world waters. These are cold waters, fresh waters. These are the most important resource when it comes to human consumption and use for drinking water. And we see Thunder River and Roaring Springs and Vasey's Paradise are examples of these high flow, relatively cool and fresh waters. But as an example, Vasey's Paradise down in the lower right hand side, if we go at a different time of year in the late fall and when the flow levels are low, we can see quite a different aspect to that spring, much less flow. So variable discharge, seasonal changes in discharge is another characteristic of springs that are dominantly fed by these upper world systems. Another set of springs, the ones that I'm particularly partial to, are the springs that are travertine depositing. Travertine is a calcium carbonate deposit, freshwater limestone, that accumulates precipitating from groundwater springs. Shown here are some of the really spectacular examples that we might see in Grand Canyon. In the upper left is Travertine Falls. It's a carbonate, literally a stone waterfall built up over thousands of years from a small spring that flows across the surface of this, depositing calcium carbonate through time. The lower left shows the Little Colorado River that we looked at before, with beautiful rimstone dams and terraces of travertine that have been built up. In the center is Havasu Creek, with beautiful rimstone dams of travertine, which trap twigs and sticks and just form the most amazing features. In the upper right is Pumpkin Spring. We'll take a look at this spring again in a few minutes. And shown in the lower right is Blue Spring, which is the source, the groundwater source, where the spring emerges into the Little Colorado River Canyon, forming the base flow of the Little Colorado River. These waters are characteristically warm. They're fizzy, and they're saline, they're salty, and you can actually have a different kind of a smell when you're near these springs. You can kind of smell the their special nature. I like that smell, but not everybody does. So we're going to think about three different types of waters. Just as we have three rock sets in Grand Canyon, let's generalize and say that we have three sets of waters. The first is the water that we want to drink. That's the fresh water, very low salt, and in general, those springs are cold. The second type of water is something that you might think of like your Gatorade. Gatorade is an electrolyte solution. That means that it has solutes in it. Those are different types of salts that make that water, of course, very helpful to replenish your own salts when you're in the hot, arid environments of the Southwest. The third type of water, I'm going to use an example of a soda pop. So what does this water have that the other two don't? If I were there in person, I would pick up that can of soda and I would start shaking it. And you would immediately remember the power of CO2. So that third water, exemplified by a soda pop, has gas in it, high amounts of gas in there. And in particular, that gas is CO2. Well, we have bubbling springs in Grand Canyon that have very, very high amounts of CO2 in them. Those are our bubbling springs that precipitate travertine. So these are the three different types of waters that I'm going to talk to you about and how we trace and examine the mixing of these waters in the Grand Canyon's groundwater systems. So we'll start with the salts. How do we use the salts as a tracer? I like to think of course, I generate huge amounts of tables of data, and instead of showing the water in table format, the water chemistry, we're going to show the water as a shape. So we're using the solutes as a tracer, and this funny shape, which you see in the center of the screen, is an example of what Tepetz Creek chemistry looks like. And we're going to look at the solutes. On the left-hand side are the sodium and potassium. The most abundant solute is sodium in general, calcium in the middle, magnesium down at the bottom. So those are three positively charged ions that are in water. If we look at the negative side, we have chloride, bicarbonate, and sulfate. Now, this particular water has the highest amount of solutes as the calcium bicarbonate. And this is a typical water that moves through a limestone aquifer because that water picks up calcium and carbonate as it dissolves the limestone plumbing system. And so this is a very characteristic shape for our waters that we like to drink, our fresh waters, like Roaring Spring. So now I'm going to show you pictures like this of a much broader set of springs in the Grand Canyon region. So now we're looking at lots of these different puzzle pieces, these different shapes of water. Toward the left in green is the example of the chemistry that's coming out of these limestone aquifers, Tepetz Creek, Roaring Spring, Bright Angel Creek, Deer and Dutton Springs, Thunder River. These things would all look like this type of a shape. The Colorado River itself, as I mentioned, is a visitor to Grand Canyon. It's flowing through. It has very distinctively different chemistry than these freshwater springs emerging in Grand Canyon. And so these two here are examples of the shapes of that upper world water type. Now our lower world waters, which are both salty and have very high CO2 and are fizzy, have very distinctively different shapes. So Elves Chasm, Joel, there's your Elves Chasm water, Lava Warm Spring, Fence Spring, these are springs that emerge right in the river corridor. And Beecher Spring, these all have a big surge out here in the area of the carbonate. So that's the extra CO2, much more than you would get from just limestone. We have extra CO2 that's very characteristic of these fizzy waters, which are all travertine producing. I also noticed that the scale is going to a value of 10 on each of these. When we go to a spring like Blue Spring, the source of the Little Colorado River, or that funny Pumpkin Spring, which I showed a picture of, we have to use different scales. These are so salty that if I depicted them at the same scale as the others, they would occupy a space bigger than the entire slide. So these are very salty waters, and main salt that they're picking up is, of course, sodium and chloride as they move through the rock strata. So these are the examples of different water types, and we can use the geochemistry to tell them apart. Now, if I've sampled hundreds of springs, it would be pretty difficult to use these shapes to make heads or tails out of the different springs. So another tool that the geochemists use is to plot each spring as a point on a diagram like this, called a Piper diagram. We look at the cations, those are the positively charged ions on this triangle. We look at the anions on this triangle, and we project them into a central parallelogram that lets us identify mixing trends. So we start to see waters and how they're chemically related to each other along these different pathways. And of course, another feature that geologists use are maps. And when we start to compare these different spring locations, we see that the paths are related to each other geographically. Here, the green points represent this particular mixing path. The blue points represent this particular mixing path. And the red points represent what we see here as we approach lava and the Western Grand Canyon. So we get geographically related differences in the water chemistry that help us understand the ways that the waters are moving. And on this map, which again shows the Colorado River from the upper right, going across the Grand Canyon area, emerging out in the west. We also have highlighted here different faults, because the processes that are happening in the geologic structures are a very important part of these flow pathways. So that's another feature that comes from a wide geographic study of spring and groundwater geochemistry through the Grand Canyon region, is that we can see trends where waters are mixing along and subdivided by different major fault systems in the Grand Canyon. So we've talked about the salts. Now let's look at the CO2-rich waters. I'm going to use the gas as a tracer, and shown in the center of the slide is the depiction of the helium atom. Helium is the most diffusible substance in the universe, actually. And we have several different isotopes of helium. So helium has an atomic number of 2, so there's 2 protons in a helium nucleus. And then the 2 types of helium shown here is helium-4. It also has 2 neutrons. But we also have helium-3, which has just 1 neutron. Helium-3 is the primordial isotope that accumulated with the planet Earth when it first formed. And helium-3 is trying its best to diffuse out of the interior of the Earth. And it finds its way by getting carried in a much more abundant gas, that is CO2. So when we think about the helium abundance in air, we have about 5 parts per million of helium in air, so it's a trace gas. But the helium-3-4 ratio in air is really small. This is 1.38 times 10 to the minus 6, so that's just a part per million level. And we call that our standard, the ratio of helium-3-4 in the air. If we go to a mid-ocean ridge, which is very different than Grand Canyon, we're forming our oceanic crust at a spreading center in the mid-ocean ridge. That magma is coming out of the Earth, and it's degassing both CO2 and helium-3 that's trying to find its way out of the Earth, and it gets entrained in these tectonic fluids. The value of helium-3-4 is much, much higher in basalts and the CO2 that is degassing from our basaltic magmatism. If we go someplace like Yellowstone, where we have a mantle plume, we have even higher amounts of that primordial helium-3, which gives us a high value of 22 relative to the ratio that's in Earth's atmosphere. On the other hand, our continental crust, which is made of very old, in part, quite old rocks, they're radiogenic. They're producing helium-4. Helium-4 is an alpha particle, which is a natural process of the decay of all the radioactive elements that are concentrated in Earth's crust. So when we have fluids and they flow through the crustal regions, this ratio of helium-3-4 becomes dominated by the helium-4, making this ratio very, very tiny. So we go to springs, and shown here is sampling the bubbles coming up in Pumpkin Spring, which is sitting right at the edge of the Colorado River itself. Down in the lower left picture, we can see the Colorado River and the beautiful travertine cistern that Pumpkin Spring has built up over thousands and thousands of years. And we're sampling the bubbles that are still coming up in that spring today. What do we see when we do that? We see that the bubbles coming out of that spring are nothing like Earth's atmosphere. The nitrogen to helium ratio is very, very high in air. It's over 10,000. And in these bubbles, it's extremely low. The helium to neon ratio is also extremely high, about 500 compared to a value of 0.28, which would be in Earth's atmosphere. The helium-3-4 ratio is very similar to what we see toward these mid-ocean ridges, or that is the kind of helium isotope ratio that we would expect to accompany basaltic magmatism. And the CO2 to helium-3 ratios also are similar to where we find basaltic magmatism occurring. So basaltic magmatism and groundwater, is that a connection that we might expect to see in Grand Canyon? Well, when we look at our regional helium isotope study, we see, of course, that it is associated with the beautiful volcanic regions of Grand Canyon. Shown here is Vulcan's Throne, a lava flow that's pouring right down into the Grand Canyon itself in Western Grand Canyon. We see the Uinkaret volcanics pouring down into the canyon region. These volcanics actually have potsherds in them, so we have very young basaltic volcanism occurring in Grand Canyon. So it's perhaps no surprise that the CO2 that we find in association with this type of magmatism is also connected into our deeper groundwater systems and affecting the chemistry of springs and helping to form travertines in Grand Canyon. So we've talked about these two. Now let's just look at the freshwater. What can we use for a tracer when we don't have too much salt and we don't have the added gas? We're going to use the water molecule itself. So shown here in the upper right is a cartoon version of a water molecule. That's H2O. And each element that's contained in water, that's the hydrogen and the oxygen, have two stable isotopes that are important for understanding recharge in groundwater systems. We can have hydrogen, which has one proton, or we can have deuterium, which is a stable isotope of hydrogen that has one proton and one neutron. It's heavier. It's twice as heavy as a hydrogen. So we can have either hydrogen or deuterium in these positions in a water molecule. And then we have two isotopes of oxygen, that is the 18, the heavier isotope, and the O16. So we have a lot of possibility of how a water molecule could be built. Now let's direct our attention to the cartoon of the hydrologic cycle on Earth in the lower left corner. What does this mean about isotope fractionation in the water cycle? Well, the standard for water isotopes on Earth is the ocean, and we call that SMO, standard mean ocean water. So by definition, we're using that as a standard. We're calling the ratio of 18 to 16 zero per mil. That means that it deviates zero parts per thousand relative to the standard, which is, of course, seawater. So that has a value of zero. When we evaporate water, which one do you think is going to preferentially evaporate? The lighter isotopes or the heavy isotopes? So if you're thinking that it might be the lighter ones, you're exactly right. The lighter isotopes preferentially evaporate into Earth's atmosphere, and then they move away over land. As the water vapor is moving away, it's condensing. That means going back from gas to water, and it's the heaviest part of that lightest part that condenses out, meaning that the remaining moisture gets lighter and lighter. That is more dominated by the 16 than the 18 when it comes to the oxygen isotope ratio. So those values become negative when we use this, what's called the delta notation, to talk about this isotopic ratio. So that's a little bit of detail, but conceptually we see that by moving through the water cycle, we can get a very different signal in our precipitation, that is our rain and snow, than we originally had in the world's ocean. So now if we examine different recharge areas, what kind of variations do we see in the isotope composition of different recharge areas? So for that, we're going to use a graph where we do a cross plot of the deuterium to hydrogen ratio expressed in parts per thousand deviation from seawater on the y-axis, and the O16 to 18 ratio expressed in parts per thousand deviation from seawater, and we make a cross plot of those two things. Because both fractionations of oxygen and deuterium are affected by the same process of what we call Rayleigh fractionation, the water will fall along this beautiful correlated line called the meteoric water line. And what puts us in different positions along this line is essentially driven by temperature. So here, seawater would be at zero, zero, so it would be way out here on this line. And all of our atmospheric moisture is going to come down in this direction, and the colder it is, the more fractionation you see. So we can have cold water fractionation processes because we're at a high elevation or a high altitude. We can be at a high latitude, like in the polar regions, or it could be winter instead of summer. So all of these are different factors that can affect our isotope fractionations. So I'm going to plot the springs and waters in the Grand Canyon region on a graph like this, and let's see what we find out. Well, it's kind of a busy plot, so let's take it apart and look at different aspects. First, we see our meteoric water line kind of scooting right through here. That's a global line, and the waters in Grand Canyon are in general conforming to behavior along this line. I've zoomed up pretty close on it, and one thing that jumps out right away is that the waters of the Colorado River itself are sitting in a different place than the indigenous spring waters that are emerging right in the canyon itself. Lake Powell sits here. The Colorado River in Grand Canyon has values that plot in this region. And then as we get down to Lake Mead, it's plotting in this area. So we're having evaporation concentrate the heavy isotopes and drive us in this direction from lower left to the right. In the Colorado River system itself. Why is it sitting down here? I would have to zoom way back and we would see these waters feeding Lake Powell are coming from the high cold Rockies that would plot in a position down here on the graph. But I want to zoom up now and look at this difference between all these different springs in Grand Canyon. And we see we have two kind of clusters that are showing up. Well, What do we see? We see that the North Rim springs are clustered down here. The South Rim springs are clustered up here. So the stable isotopes are giving us a clear indication of two different recharge areas. That is recharge in the higher elevation, snow-dominated North Rim region versus the South Rim waters. So the isotopes themselves are a good tracer that help us understand recharge. We can also use this in conjunction with the salt chemistry and the gas chemistry to understand mixing and identify different flow paths in Grand Canyon. So when we put up a cartoon now, instead of the simple diagram where we saw just water coming from the rain and snow and infiltrating down and emerging, we see that in the subsurface of Grand Canyon, our use of natural tracers shows us really important aspects about the mixing that occurs, and also the importance of faults to this distribution pathways. And so a cartoon of Grand Canyon is going to have our three sets of rocks, the flat-lying Paleozoic rocks, the tilted supergroup rocks, and our basement rocks. We also have different fault structures that penetrate and slice and dice this aquifer stratigraphy, providing more complexity to the flow paths. And finally, we have different water types that we have identified through their geochemical characteristics, where we have fast-traveling, fresh, cold, high-discharge springs related to recharge. We have much further-traveled waters that include salts that they pick up on their long journey in the subsurface. And finally, we have carbonic fluids that are related to our volcanism coming up along fault structures mixing into the Redwall Muav Aquifer and emerging in Grand Canyon, and also associated with depositing the beautiful travertine deposits that we see in the Grand Canyon area. Well, with that, I think I will stop my share and come back to you, Joel. And at least you got a little glimpse of where Elves Chasm Spring would be on a point on a graph, but I think that will not suffice. You will have to go there in person.
Exactly, yes. I will. Well, yeah, thank you very much for all. That was amazing. That was super informative. I took a stable isotopes course as in graduate school. God, it's so intricate and complex, and it never ceases to amaze me, though. The power of visualizing data, and I feel like that's it's important in science in general, but in geochemistry, I mean, like you said, you've just got tables and tables of numbers. And you got to find ways to actually visualize them and make sense of them. And like with the shapes, of each spring has its own shape, that's kind of, I think that's a really cool concept. It was a fascinating, like I said, a fascinating course. I'm not a hydrology person, but it's a fascinating subject. And it's really kind of amazing to think about the fact that you can like look at this vast landscape of Grand Canyon and this, all these little pockets of water and life, scattered throughout this whole huge vast area. And you can look at individual ones and actually figure out like kind of what's happening there. Where is this water coming from?
Yeah.
What kind of water is it?
In that way, Joel, I kind of think of like these springs as being like volcanoes, except they're just water. Mm. So if you think about it, as you know, there are so many people that are fascinated with volcanoes and the active eruptions and what happens at the surface. Those are volcanologists. And there's an entire huge realm of study of just the volcanic features themselves. But there's other types of geologists that are more interested in looking at what the volcano tells us about the deep earth interior and the magmas and the mingling and where's the melting happening and how does that relate to plate tectonics. So with springs, it's the same way. We have people rightly very focused on the wonderful variety of ecosystems that are present, associated with these areas of precious water in an arid landscape. And so they're very interested in studying, all those aspects of the ecosystem, and which is very dependent on the water. Well, when I go there, I'm really kind of like trying to look into the tailpipe of that spring and say, okay, but why here? Why these characteristics? Why is this water the way it is? And of course, especially the waters that produce those amazing, amazing travertines, which could be a topic just unto themselves, just a spectacular travertine. So I'm happy to entertain questions people have about the travertines of Grand Canyon or the spring chemistry. So. But now, at least, I think by associating him with waters that we think of, freshwater, Gatorade, a soda pop, we can sort of think, wow, yeah, those are really different. Fast freshwater, groundwater, salty water that's had a very long and interesting history, salty just like a sailor telling its tales, and then a soda pop, which is just a very, very powerful fluid. If I was sitting with you at a table and I shook up my Coke, I could do a lot of damage in a whole room and to that electronic equipment with just one can of soda pop. So never underestimate the power of CO2.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Now I remember my first hike I actually ever did down into Grand Canyon was down to Ribbon Falls, along the North Kaibab Trail. And that travertine apron on Ribbon Falls just blew me away. And I mean, this was like at the end of my senior year as an undergraduate. It's before grad school. First time I'd ever hiked down into Grand Canyon. Of course, I worked here as a ranger. And that I still think back to that moment. And that's kind of when I think I fell in love with this place, was looking at that waterfall and that gigantic moss-covered travertine apron, and be like, this is amazing.
Well, I think the other place that people most often associate with, you know, and I'm talking worldwide, are the gorgeous Travertines and the blue waters of Havasu.
Of course. Incredible.
And, you know, as you mentioned, I've worked around the world, and I can tell you that these carbonic springs are always connected to the stories of the people who call those landscapes their home. Very important features, high cultural value. So everyone knows that those are special, special locations.
Absolutely, yeah.
Worth preserving.
Haven't had the, yes, oh, absolutely. Yeah, I haven't had the chance to get down to Havasu Falls yet, on the Havasu by reservation yet myself. I've been trying to get a permit to hike down there, and for the past couple of years, and I finally got one this year. It's of course because of COVID, the whole, you know, the Havasu by have shut down all tourism, you know, to the falls. My permit is for later this year, and we'll see what happens. They are allowing folks to reschedule for next year, so I'll get down there. I'm going to get down there and see those waterfalls here one of these days.
Yeah, and of course the other waterfalls, Vases, Roaring Spring, Thunder River, another spectacular hike, Deer Creek. You know, just one of the most incredible places to visit, whether you're in the river, you know, on a river trip or hiking in. It is so often the water, the spring, the beautiful surrounding areas and ecosystems that are an attractive hiking destination for many, many people.
Yeah. A lot of times the folks first visiting the canyon, they'll be standing up there on the rim and they'll be looking out at it and be like, well where's the river? Is the river dried up? You know, and I'm like, no, it's down there. It's down there. And not just the river. I kind of like the idea of it being a visitor. I never really thought about it quite in that way, it being a visitor through the region. And then you have all of these native waters that are actually, you know, kind of the residents of the region. Colorado That's River right. is passing through. But yeah, I try to impress upon folks. No. There's a river down there. And there's a lot of other water scattered everywhere too, and all these little pockets of greenery and life, and each one is, it's like you said, its own ecosystem.
Yes. The Colorado River flowing through the Grand Canyon area is regulated by the dam releases up at the upper end, and in the days before there was a dam, the river could get to quite low flow levels during times of drought. And if we didn't have that regulated release, the water levels would be very low in the river. Mm. So if you think by analogy with the Little Colorado River, that thing can be very high flow, and then it's muddy when it's carrying runoff waters and seasonal waters. Mm. But then the rest of the time, you just see this little trickle of this incredible blue water. Well, that would be the base flow in the Colorado River itself if we weren't manipulating it so much. And so what we're finding throughout the Western United States is that as recharge diminishes, as snowpacks diminish, we start to see a bigger effect of these lower world waters, the natural groundwaters everywhere along the Colorado path. Hey, go up to Glenwood Springs. You want to see a high flow, lower world water, go look at Glenwood Springs erupting CO2 and salt and building travertine right in the Colorado River. And if we didn't have as much snowpack, the river quality would start to become more and more salty. So as interesting and wonderful as I think those tectonic fluids are, they have high salts, they have things like high arsenic, high uranium, other natural metals that are associated with that deep circulation that is not good for water quality.
Yeah. All right. Well, thank you very much. Unless there was anything else you wanted to mention?
I just look forward to the questions from the folks that are watching either real time or delayed.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, again, yeah, thank you very much for being with us today, Dr. Crossey.
I'll see you in the river, on the river.
Hopefully. Have not had the chance yet to float the river through the canyon. It's very high on my list of things I want to do.
All right, one way or the other. Goodbye, Joel.
Bye.
All right. Well, hello, everyone. And I hope you enjoyed that last talk on the groundwater and travertines of Grand Canyon. Who knew that there were so many hydrothermal fluids coming up from underneath inside Grand Canyon? And actually, we didn't really know that much about it until fairly recent work, like what Dr. Crossey was just talking about in that last talk. Now for our next and final talk of the Grand Canyon Geology Festival, or GeoFest 2020, I'm going to be focusing on a different type of water, a type of water that people have known about and have been using here in Grand Canyon for thousands of years. Freshwater seeps and springs fed by rain and snow coming down through the rocks from up on the plateaus. And before that next talk, I've brought you out here to another magical place here down inside Grand Canyon. You know, we were talking about that sense of place earlier and human connections to geologic landscapes. Well, I'm standing here at a pretty incredible place called Dripping Springs. It's a side hike from the Hermit Trail. A lot of you out there might not be familiar with the Hermit Trail. If you are looking for a hike where you get dramatic, expansive, sweeping views of the main Grand Canyon and the Colorado River, this is not the hike for you. But if you are looking for an amazing, quiet experience, some solitude and peace and quiet at a really beautiful green oasis of life and water down here inside Grand Canyon, then Dripping Springs is an incredible hike. Now, Native peoples living in Grand Canyon have been using springs like these for a very, very long time. Of course, in a desert landscape like down in Grand Canyon, anywhere where there's water, that's a pretty important place. And today, springs like these are also pretty important to backpackers hiking down inside Grand Canyon. And as I said, they are fed by rain and snow from up on the plateaus, actually coming down through layers of rock, as we'll learn in our next and final talk. There are actually two main aquifers in Grand Canyon, places where porous rocks like sandstone and limestone are sitting directly on very impermeable rocks like shales and siltstones. And water coming down from the surface up on those plateaus permeates down through those porous permeable rocks until it hits those impermeable layers, and then it moves sideways. And it emerges eventually into Grand Canyon from the very walls of the canyon itself, like this amazing dripping spring right here. And that is what we're going to be talking about in our next and final talk. So I hope you've enjoyed all of these talks over the course of a whole week. I hope you've enjoyed the talks here today. Thanks for tuning in. Once again, I'm Park Ranger Joel Kane. It's been an honor to host this event over the course of the entire week. Thank you, everyone, for watching.
All right. Well, hello, everybody, and welcome to our final talk here on the final day of Grand Canyon Geology Festival, or what we're calling GeoFest 2020. Today we've been bringing things kind of to the here and now. We've spent a lot of time this week talking about events and processes over millions or even billions of years. And here in the last day, we're trying to bring things back to, like I said, present day, the time of human beings, the human timescales. And one big thing we've been talking about a lot today is water. We're kind of the lifeblood of Grand Canyon, not just the Colorado River, but a lot of other waters in the canyon as well. And we just heard from Dr. Laura Crossey about certain types of groundwaters in Grand Canyon. Here to talk to us more about that is Dr. Abe Springer, who's a professor of hydrogeology and ecohydrology at the university or at Northern Arizona University. He's the inaugural director of the School of Earth Sciences and Environmental Sustainability there at Northern Arizona University. So thank you very much for joining us here today, Dr. Springer.
Thank you, Joel.
Of course.
Okay. Well, thank you, Joel. Thanks for the introduction. Let me go ahead and share my presentation with everyone here. And as Joel indicated, and you've had, as those of you who are able to participate and hear Lori Crossey's introduction, Lori went over the entire hydrologic system, but focused on the deeper waters of Grand Canyon National Park. What I'd like to give you a better appreciation and understanding for is the water supplies for the park, where they're sourced from, what they support for humans and ecosystems and cultures, and how they're important in backcountry as well. So I'll mostly talk about the springs and the aquifers that supply them. And I'll try to give you as many pretty pictures as we can. This one happens to be a picture of Angel Springs, which is the headwater source for Bright Angel Creek. Most people would think Roaring Springs is the source, but actually further up Bright Angel Creek, Angel Springs is the source for it. So you guys know a lot of this by now if you watched some of the talks or been in the canyon. The park has a very diverse change in elevation and climate. So it goes from arid desert climates in the bottom of the canyon to up on the Kaibab Plateau to humid climates. And for us as scientists studying the canyon, it's challenging for groundwater because groundwater is invisible. It's all beneath the surface. There almost aren't any wells that drill down to the aquifers that we can use to understand it. There's no oil and gas potential in this region, so there's almost no geophysics lines. The aquifers are deep and hard to see, but there are over 750 springs in the park that give us these little windows and aquifers into the aquifers to understand their structure and function. Also, what's really unique about water flow in Grand Canyon National Park is it's turned it into a cave park. Most people don't know or recognize it as a cave park, but this figure I'm showing you here is an image, a topographic image that highlights all these little black points are all the sinkholes. On the Kaibab Plateau, there are over 6,000 little closed depressions that are sinkholes or windows down into the shallow Kaibab limestone. And there's many caves in the park, but they're all very sensitive resources and very important to manage, protect the biological and cultural resources in them. This karst landscape is important not only for the hydrology and the water sources we'll talk about, but it's also important, as other speakers have talked to you about, on helping understand the age and formation of the canyon itself. And there's a lot more to study there. The other important thing with water flow in this system is the concerns, and I won't really talk about it today, but is the influences of pumping in nearby and adjacent places to the canyon and potential influences on the water chemistry from uranium mining in the region. There's been a lot of research done on water in the canyon. You've heard from some of these people if you've caught most of the talks in the series. And I'm just gonna highlight some of these things in my talk today from various people. I'm gonna first divide it by giving you a briefer overview of the geology of the area south of the canyon, which is what I'm showing you here in the area north of the canyon. So all these stars here show springs along the south rim of the canyon that have measurable discharge. There's many other springs that don't have discharge you can measure. The biggest spring by far is one here at Havasu Springs. Water flow south of the canyon is largely influenced by the locations of major faults, big cracks in the earth where they focus groundwater flow. Next thing I'm going to show you is this slice of the earth all the way across from the Grand Canyon to the south through Tucson, through Valley, over this volcanic field down to the Verde Valley. This is one that was made years ago by Monty Montgomery, some you may know or seen, but it's interesting. It shows you the different colored layers are the different geologic formations, the different stratigraphic layers. The brown down here in the bottom is the basement, which you've heard a lot of speakers talk about, and it's how it helps understand the age of formation of the bottom of the canyon. And then there's this light blue unit down here. We recall the R aquifer, which is the red wall, limestone and Muav formation. And that's the primary water yielding zone for the canyon, but it is very deep below land surface. It's largely recharged in the higher elevation areas in the volcanic mountain fields, or where there's these white lines, where there's various faults or fractures where stormwater flow from flood events gets quickly through those fractures. So that aquifer is really deep, and this region's dry. It rarely gets precipitation. Usually our precipitation comes mostly in the winter, a little bit in the summer. And of that precipitation, a very small percentage of it, only about 2 to 4% of it actually gets through the rocks, the fractures and sinkholes down to the aquifer. Water gets there in only in focused places, just in faults and sinkholes. And it's really spotty when it happens. It's usually just when there's snowmelt or a really big monsoon storm. Most of the year, most of the rain just evaporates and goes right back to the atmosphere, or the plants pull it out of the soil and transpire it back. So the amount of evaporation and transpiration, it is much greater than what recharges the system. Other dominant features of the groundwater flow system is, you know, when you've driven up to the south rim, you drive up. So the rocks dip away from the south rim, and groundwater flow mostly follows the dip of the rocks there. So the springs along the south rim, and I'll show you this in some maps in a moment, are largely contributed just by precipitation that falls near the rim. On the north side, though, the rocks dip towards the rim, so they capture a little more rainfall, and you get bigger springs along the north rim. Most of the springs in the park issue from what we call the R aquifer, which is that deeper limestone aquifer, and at the base of that is a shale unit, which is a really tight hydrologic unit that it keeps water from seeping through it. So I'll switch over to the Kaibab Plateau for a moment. It's a little different conceptually on flow of water than the North Rim. At the surface, the rocks are really dissolved. There's all those sinkholes I showed you, and then there's faults and fractures. So water gets through them. Some of it comes out laterally through some caves and sinkholes, largely in the Torweep Formation, and some in the Coconino. And then a lot of water seeps down through faults down into the lower limestone units. So most of the big springs in the canyon come out the Red Wall and the lower Amua, perched on top of this bright angel shale. On the south rim, a nice photo view of this. I'm standing here on Horseshoe Mesa and took a photo back towards Grandview Point. So you can see how deep the springs occur under the rim. So up Cottonwood Creek, there's a number of springs which come out largely behind talus on slopes and then emerge in this Cottonwood Creek and make an intermittent reach of Cottonwood Creek. But the water is coming out of these lower limestone units way down here. So they're over 1,000 feet beneath the surface. So at the surface, again, there's this shallow karst formation, and then there's this lower limestone unit, which has caves and karst in it as well. We can't divorce our understanding and discussion of hydrology in the shallower system without thinking about the influences of climate. Over the last 30 years, since the mid-90s mostly, we've been in a dry phase of climate, and that's influenced the amount of water that can recharge the system. And we've seen that in the responses of springs in the park. There's been a gradual decline over the last 25 years of discharge based on lower input. You see that with the smaller springs that have a smaller contributing area more quickly than the larger springs that contribute water from a larger area. There's also concerns on longer term scales on what the effects of longer term changes in climate will be. There was a recent paper put out by Francis O'Donnell. I've highlighted the reference here. If any of you want to look at it, or we can have Joel make sure it's available and anybody wants to see it. That gives some insight into what happens on the Kaibab Plateau over the next 100 years from vegetation change. The Kaibab Plateau is anticipated, as it dries out, to lose more of the mixed conifer forest, have less overall forest cover, increased chance of wildfire, and all that's going to cause there to be less recharge. So the climate not only is going to be drier, but it's going to be a magnifying effect where there's less likely to be water recharge to the aquifer. So there's concerns about the long-term sustainability of these systems based on climate. So how does the North Rim aquifer function? It's a pretty cool, unique karst system. This is a picture of one of those 6,000 sinkholes. So you can see in winter snowmelt season, I'm showing you here two different drainage channels where water flows into. And this never fills up and overflows. The water's flowing into here and disappearing down into the aquifer. Where does it go? The water goes down vertically through fractures and sinkholes and eventually daylights in springs. This is the water supply source spring for Grand Canyon National Park. This is Roaring Springs. So the water for both the North and South Rims comes from here via pipelines and lift stations. And in up here where this water cascades up into here is where the intake is for the Trans Canyon water line. Now, Peter Huntoon, in his dissertation work, was the first person to describe what this cave system looks like that contributes water flow to Roaring Springs. And we put in 5 years ago some instrumentation to continuously measure the flow in Roaring Springs. So we have a really good understanding on how it responds. And this is an example of that response. You wouldn't think a spring that deep, that far away from snowmelt would respond quick. You might think it might take hundreds of thousands of years, but we see that from a rainfall event, this is a monsoon event from 2015, I'm showing you here, that within 2 days, there was a response of discharge of the spring. And also within a couple days of temperature. So on the Kaibab Plateau, water, when it's available through snowmelt or ephemeral streams flowing, rapidly is transmitted through sinkholes, conduits, and faults to springs. The rest of the year, it flows really slowly from the surrounding rocks draining, but there's both this fast and slow flow system on there. We've done some work to try to figure out which sinkholes contribute to which springs to try to protect Roaring Springs, and we've done that through what are called dye tracer studies. So food-grade fluorescent dyes have been introduced 3 different years into 2 sinkholes each year. This is a shot of one of those. And this is a map indicating, in general, where these points of introduction of sinkholes were, these circles here and here and here. And these arrows indicate directions that we think that the dye moved. What we did for these tracer studies is at over 40 sites through the canyon, from South Canyon all the way down to Deer Creek, we put in passive dye receptors, just some charcoal packets, that when water flows over them, it absorbs the dye. We can then pull that charcoal pack out, send it to a lab, look for the presence of the dye. So all these sites here that have colors indicate where we've seen these dyes of different introduction points be observed in different springs. Karst systems are very complex, and the flow doesn't always match your theory, and that's what we found here. We found things have flown unanticipated places. The first 2 years we did the work, none of the places we thought flow went to Roaring Springs went to Roaring Springs. It went to other places. It went as far east as Basies, and it went as far west as to Pete's Creek and Thunder River. So we're still trying to work better to figure out which areas on the Kaibab Plateau contribute directly to Roaring Springs, and we're lining up to do some more of those dye tracer studies in the future. With all these great new data, I showed you that sinkhole map of the 6,000 points. Natalie Jones, a recent technician here at NAU, developed this tool to describe the vulnerability of the karst aquifer from the geology. So what she did was she correlated on the left for the shallow Kaibab aquifer, and on the right, the deeper Redwall aquifer, the vulnerability zones of those aquifers, which really line up with fault and fracture zones. So these zones on the rim are the areas that provide the most vulnerability to the underlying aquifer, indicate places which might receive different types of management attention to manage runoff or contribution to sinkholes when it's flowing for the water supply. Just a couple last things to highlight here, importance for springs. Mostly I've focused on the importance for humans and water supply. I wanted to finish up for a few other things here. There's also been a bit of recent work done by the Spring Stewardship Institute and others to look at the types of ecosystems supported by springs in the greater Grand Canyon ecoregion. From those work, we found that about half of all the plants in the greater Grand Canyon ecoregion occur at springs. And those are just the springs that have been observed, which is a pretty small number. And that's a very small percentage of the landscape. So these springs are extraordinarily important for supporting the diversity of plant life that exists in this region. We've also found that the diversity of plant life we find correlates to the diversity of the geomorphology that exists at a spring. So a spring like Thunder River, which has just this tremendous geomorphic diversity, also has a very rich diversity of life at it. And the last thing I want to point out, some economic value. This was some work we did with Julie Miller in our College of Business and one of our graduate students, Ryan Lima. We did a nationwide willingness to pay survey, and we found that even if Americans haven't been to Grand Canyon National Park, they recognize the value of them and they're willing to invest in them. So there's this significant willingness to pay to maintain the values of backcountry springs and Grand Canyon National Park, not just the big water, charismatic water supply springs, but all the backcountry ones. And the area of concern that people thought was most important is the value of springs for supporting a habitat. So there, I just gave you a quick overview of the importance of the aquifers of this region for the science behind contributing to understanding the sources of water and their values for ecosystems and for people. So Joel, happy to lead some discussion here with you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, thanks so much. And of course, as human beings, water's kind of important to us. So it's obviously a very important subject to us here at Grand Canyon. And one thing, of course, we've been talking about a lot the past couple of years is that that pipeline that goes from Roaring Springs all the way down to the bottom of the canyon and all the way back up to the South Rim to supply us with all of our drinking water here on the South Rim. And the fact that that pipeline is 50 years old, and in desperate need of work. And that's, of course, a major project. So that's one thing that's been on our minds a lot here at the park the past couple of years. A couple of years ago, I finally did my first real backpacking hike down inside the canyon, outside the main corridor, in areas where you really do have to rely on some of these springs for survival. You're planning on getting to the next spring, so you can get water and purify it and be able to, be able to drink while you're hiking down there. So, and that really, really kind of hammered home to me just how important these things are to people. And there's nothing quite like being, way down inside Grand Canyon out in the backcountry and, kind of scrounging for water out of this little spring, because your life depends on it. So,
yeah, every hike and backcountry expedition depends on the careful planning of accessibility of water resources. And they're difficult to monitor. The best monitoring tool is what the backcountry office generates from citizen science. So when people are out there making observations, I know the backcountry office records that because it's difficult for us, obviously, to visit every spring every week. And you can't put cellular connections out there to have a signal or a photo of a spring. So, as you know, for all kinds of backcountry resources, they're difficult to monitor and to describe.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, we only have so many backcountry rangers, and they can't get around to, you know, to all those water sources and keep tabs on them all the time. So yeah, folks who are hiking out there giving us reports, yeah, we absolutely rely on that. But it's like what you said kind of at the beginning of the talk, the fact that all of this water that's recharging these aquifers, it's down there, it's in the rocks, it's doing things, it's moving around, but we can't see it, it's invisible. So it's one of those things that's kind of hard to talk about here at Grand Canyon, to folks who are visiting the park, to talk about that water, because they can't see it. And a lot of these springs, of course, are thousands of feet down inside the canyon, so a lot of folks, you know, who are just up here visiting the park on the rim aren't going to see them. But it's something I like to talk about because it's so important. And some of
the conditions are hard to observe, so the condition which is really exciting on the Kaibab Plateau is snowmelt season. Normally the roads are closed and the area is closed, so most of the public doesn't get up there to observe that season. That's why we like to do these presentations and show the pictures and help people get an understanding about what that region's like during the closure season.
Yeah, and I love talking about how just kind of a unique landscape this is in a lot of ways, of course, but also in terms of the fact that you have this massive amount of karst topography that's been uplifted to such a high elevation. And it makes for some really interesting processes that are kind of influencing the Grand Canyon landscape. And one fact I'd like to throw out there to folks is that Grand Canyon National Park actually has it protects more karst topography than any other park except for Everglades. Now, of course, Everglades is at sea level, so a little bit different than what we're dealing with here.
I think is that the third or fourth longest cave in the national park system is now in Grand Canyon.
Yeah.
Some pretty amazing karst features. And there's more caves in Grand Canyon National Park than any other national park.
Yeah, that's another fact I like to throw out there that a lot of folks don't realize is just how many caves are in the park. And of course, I do want to throw out there that even though Grand Canyon does have a lot of caves, a lot of them are incredibly hard to access, and they are all closed to the public for a number of reasons, partially because they are so important to the aquifer system, and also because a lot of them have resources in them like fossils, in some cases Native American, you know, remains of human occupation or human use. But they're pretty neat features. There was one cave in the park that was open to the public, Cave of the Domes, which is one that I've actually been inside. Unfortunately, it's no longer open to the public. But
other part of cave access is the need to protect the biological resources. In the COVID era, you're all familiar with the theory of how COVID was transmitted to humans. Well, the reverse happens as well. It's possible to transmit COVID back to other mammals. So that's one of the emerging concerns about cave resource protection, is to make sure that humans aren't transmitting COVID back to some of the biological resources in caves and other parts of the park.
Yeah, and I really like your point about how important these springs are to biological communities, to the ecology of the park, and something I that is kind of hard for people to envision when they're standing on the rim, because you're looking out at this vastness and you're not down there, is the fact that there are all these little springs out there, and each one is its own little ecosystem, its own little pocket of life. And there's things living there that you won't find, you know, hardly anywhere else in the canyon. Grand Canyon's got got over 2,000 plant species in it, more than almost any other national park. And a big part of that biodiversity is largely due to all those springs. So,
if you know where to look, from many of the charismatic viewpoints of the park, you're looking down on springs. So. In the main South Rim Quarter, you look right down on Pipe Creek Spring and on Burrow Spring.
Yeah, absolutely. Angel Springs, I didn't even know about.
I feel like that's the first picture I've ever seen of Angel Springs.
It's a pretty challenging access.
I can imagine.
I'll just leave it at that.
One thing I did want to ask about I was talking earlier about how the karst topography up here on the plateaus and how that channels water down into these aquifer systems, which then eventually ends up emerging out into the canyon, results in a lot of kind of interesting processes that are influencing the canyon itself. And one process I like to talk about sometimes, but I'm sure you know a lot more about than I do, is spring sapping, and how that is kind of helping to widen the canyon. It's one of those canyon widening processes. And it's kind of it kind of makes Grand Canyon, I think, fairly unique in when you compare it to other canyons, and how most canyons are carved largely by rivers and streams starting from the top and cutting downward. Grand Canyon in a lot of places is actually kind of widening, being formed by processes happening thousands of feet below from the bottom up.
Yeah, and probably I'll give you a different national park that's adjacent for a clear example is the canyons of the Escalante, because the springs there come out of the Navajo sandstone. So the groundwater sapping is what forms almost all the canyons of the Escalante, and they have a characteristically different geomorphology. They tend to be U-shaped and an amphitheater head. And a lot of the hanging gardens the other example for cultures is many of the cliff dwelling ruins in the Four Corners area are on springs that groundwater sapped and formed the alcove. So cultures carefully pick sites, not only for the sun aspect and other things, but also for having a water supply right in the middle of the alcove. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, we see that here in Grand Canyon too. I know there's a lot of places where like granaries, and such were built, in cliff bands and places where they're eroding back, and they're covered and they're protected from, from the elements. So, oh, very cool. All right. Unless there was anything else you wanted to mention or to add.
Go out there and, be careful, be respectful of our springs. They're important, valuable resources, and they're an important part of your national park.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Springer, for that talk. And I hope everyone has had a great week of these talks here at the Grand Canyon Geology Festival, GeoFest 2020. I think we got one more kind of wrap-up talk a little bit after this to kind of close everything down. But that's our final one of the talks here for the week. So thanks very much for joining us, everybody, and hopefully some folks will have some questions afterwards we can get to. So, all right. Well, thank you very much again, Dr. Springer, for being here with us today.
You're welcome. Hopefully I didn't go too far over time.
Oh, no. I know it's, there's so many interesting things to talk about. It's very easy. I'm guilty of it myself. All of my talks always run on the long side. So, yeah. All right. Well, hello again, everyone, for one last time. This is Park Ranger Joel Kane. Happy proud to have been the host of this event over the course of the whole week. And wow, what a week of geology here at Grand Canyon. It's been a really, really awesome week. We're just going to take a few minutes here at the end of this, the final day, to kind of recap the Grand Canyon Geology Festival GeoFest here over the course of the last week.
That's great, Joel. Thank you for being our host this week. I'm Laura Crossey from the University of New Mexico, one of the co-conveners of the event. And I just wanted to give the folks here who've been along for the ride all week during Earth Science Week to see a glimpse behind the scenes. We conceived of this virtual GeoFest just in September, a short month ago. And wow, it was a very short amount of time and yet really, really amazing. So we're so glad that it came together the way it has on the part of so many people who have put efforts in there. It was patterned on the park's really successful virtual star party that they held in the inability of doing the real star party event, which is a celebration of Grand Canyon's dark sky status and a really outstanding event. So I hope you can even go back and look at some of that virtual star party material. But we patterned our ideas, and Raider Lane, who has done so much work in that, was shared a lot of his successes. So we built on the shoulders of that successful Grand Canyon National Park event. And now here we are with a virtual GeoFest almost in our rearview mirror.
And, you know, we like the stars too, and we realize that the dark skies aspect of Grand Canyon is really a nice resource. But for heaven's sakes, you can only see them at night, and the geology is there every day, all day, and it's a primary resource too. So the GeoFest, you know, thanks to Raider for setting up the format, but we thought geology ought to benefit from that same kind of approach. And what a great partnership. You know, Joel, you've been fantastic with all those hikes you had to do, and Raider sort of led the way with some of the technical things. Michael Quinn at Creative Media, you know, was essential in terms of uploading stuff to Facebook. And Lori was up late at night doing the captioning. I have to say, for many of the talks, we didn't quite get them all done in time, but they will be done in time to be posted.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks so much to both of you, of course, for all the incredible work that you did on this. I mean, it was mostly your idea, Laurie. The programs, you know, were mostly Carl. Thanks for wrangling and roping in all of our amazing speakers over the course of the week. You know, like you said, this came together pretty quick. They jumped on it, got these talks together, set up times to sit down, you know, to sit down with me. I did all those recordings of the Zoom talks in our distance learning studio at Grand Canyon National Park. And I'd like to thank our resource education staff for kind of putting up with that, for me being in and out of there so much, and utilizing that space. I'm not there right now, unfortunately, which is why I'm a little darker than normal, and my background isn't quite as good. And and I'm not in uniform, unfortunately, at the moment. But I got a Centennial, you know, Park Service Centennial shirt on. So, but yeah, all these talks, in addition to hopefully everyone out there enjoying them, you know, and they're also going to be an incredible resource for us at the park to teach our park rangers about the geology of Grand Canyon. You know, myself, I've got a geology background. A lot of our park rangers don't. And, you know, especially when they're new to the park, they come in and we're giving them, you know, a crash course in Grand Canyon geology. And these talks are going to be an incredible help in that going forward. So, again, yeah, thanks to both of you for putting all that together. And I want to give some personal shout outs as well to Raider. Cause like you said, he really paved the way with his star party. You know, I kind of tried to expand a little bit, you know, part of the star party, of course, is actually looking at stars, not just listening to, you know, awesome talks from astronomers. And in this, you know, in addition to just listening to awesome talks by geologists and geoscientists, and I wanted to add a component of actually going out in the field and having a look at some of these things. So like you said, I did do quite a bit of hiking and going out and filming, you know, to kind of tie it all together. So I hope that came over really well. Mike Quinn was a huge help with everything, you know, on the technical side. Ronnie Colvin, you know, and the paleontology folks, you know, with all the stuff for National Fossil Day. So yeah, it's really been an amazing collaborative effort.
Well, yeah, Joel, the transitions kind of built through the week, and I know you were facing some record heat in Grand Canyon at that time. So, you know, thank you for your heroism in generating those really nice transitions to give people a feel for what the park is right.
Yeah, definitely. Right,
We also, I just to recap for people that haven't really seen every single bit of it, is that we ended up with 25 talks by 18 different guests, including active researchers on Grand Canyon geology, including interpreters from the area who work on outreach to Grand Canyon, and of course, the park folks, including Anne, who gave a talk on the Paleo Day. So the topics that we covered was the three sets of rocks and the rock record, unconformities about missing time, fossils were the focus of Wednesday's coincidence with National Fossil Day. Telling time, I think one of the most neat set of talks is that inside look into the laboratories where the ages of Grand Canyon rocks are being refined through ongoing National Science Foundation funded research projects. The canyon itself, the carving of the canyon, the topic that we're hearing about towards the end, and then geoscience education and, ever important, the resource of water and how that links to Grand Canyon geology. So those are just some of the topics. On Facebook, these videos are still accessible. And in fact, you can still go and insert in questions into the chat. And our, our host of speakers are still kind of keeping an eye on that. So hold out for some answers there in those in that Facebook format, but eventually it will be ported over to YouTube, which has a separate a life of its own.
Yeah, the goal, I think, was to portray the geology of Grand Canyon sort of as a summary for people who are just learning about it, but also as a as an update in terms of recent progress. And that's a challenge to try and reach all levels. We hope you got something out of it at whatever level you brought into it, and that you went away at a slightly or significantly higher learning level. This science literacy part of this week, to me, is the motivator. Grand Canyon National Park, all the national parks have a wonderful opportunity to inform the public in formal science education. And it's so important in this day and age that that the general public recognizes science and how scientific method works and how progress gets made. And so that part of it, I'll come back to that in just a minute. That was an important aspect, I think.
Yeah, one of the other interesting comparisons, I think, compared to, you know, park interp and other content areas, let's just take, you know, biology and ecology. You can compare maybe a critter talk with a rock talk about the three sets of rocks. And as geoscientists, we find that in general, the public is a little bit less, you know, aware of some of the fundamentals of the geosciences in a way that, you know, where they're more familiar with other aspects of nature, say ecology in a forest, a desert, and these different ecosystems.
They know what a squirrel is.
They know what a squirrel is already, whereas they're maybe not so sure about a schist. So we have to, you know, go in and do, I think, in these geological presentations, we need to get more into the fundamentals, talking about plate tectonic theory, whereas a critter talk is not going to delve into evolutionary theory to that same level. So we kind of have a really neat task as scientists and as science communicators. And this set of videos, I think, provides a step into a direction that's, you know, a deeper look. And we hope that these will continue to be a resource, as Joel said, both for the park themselves and, of course, for the public.
Yeah, so just a few more thoughts on interpretation. We heard a talk about place-based learning. Grand Canyon is, in my mind, the archetypal place for learning because people get attached to the place, and because it's about Grand Canyon, they're open. They have a teachable moment when they see the vistas and think about the landscapes. So place-based learning is a way to reach people at a really important level. And then, you know, the ties to the indigenous cultures that have used Grand Canyon, have lived there for a long time. That's a really important thing. Those groups have been doing science in their own right for generation after generation. They know where to find the water and the right clay for pots. And that's science. And so it's another opportunity, I think, through geosciences to make cultural connections and emphasize the importance of this continuum of gathering knowledge about this place that we love. One thing that came up was kind of interesting. You heard a lot about the three sets of rocks and the Shinimu Islands that were covered by the transgressing Cambrian seas. You know, that was a concept. It's a confusing concept, but it's one that in the 1930s, Mary Coulter and Eddie McKee and all the scientists felt was a level that could be communicated to the public. And so it's a message to us that we can aim high, up our game, and really try. And even though there's sometimes there'll be some confusions, let's keep trying to increase the sort of sophistication of the knowledge that's imparted to the public, always going back to bring up the lower learning levels as well. And this concept of multiple learning hierarchies or multiple learning levels, I find is a good guide to think about your audience is diverse. We're all challenged to meet, to speak to multiple levels. But if we can do that by explaining difficult words in the context of simpler ones or emphasizing the concepts and not the terminology, that's a really good thing. And our goal, you know, since the Trail of Time and continuing to work with the park, I think there's an opportunity for Grand Canyon National Park to take the lead. They already are in many ways with geoscience education in the Park Service. And that involves integration of different elements, Trail of Time, Yavapai Museum, the website, the interpretation program, the formal education program. The more integration and discussion amongst these different groups, it'll just keep improving is my hope, my goal. A couple comments about research. There were great research, great questions from the chat about research. One was, you know, how does the Colorado Plateau lift up and the layers stay flat? And it's a research question. It involves looking deep in the earth and the geophysics of the earth. It involves buoyancy. An iceberg raises up without rotating. So there's a lot of great fundamental questions which are also approachable at different levels. The how old is the Grand Canyon? I think we've made good progress in saying there's different segments of Grand Canyon. Each one has a little different history, and we have to put together a longer history of the Grand Canyon landscape than just the specific question of how the river's carving down, which is also a great question. And then all the stories of the rocks. I think almost all of the speakers touched on the fact that each of these rock layers, rock units, has its own chapter of a book or story to tell. And there's lots and lots to learn about each of those stories. Just would encourage future research to think of researchers to think about this idea that Grand Canyon, because it's so well exposed, can have global reverberations, things you learn about a particular rock layer. By necessity, I think you need to look outside the Grand Canyon to make comparisons. But what you learn in Grand Canyon about that particular period of time that's well exposed in Grand Canyon could have far-reaching impact on the science in general. And then when we get to resources, you know, how do you define the park's mission is to preserve and protect the resource and also use it for the enjoyment of the American public. What a challenge. And, you know, this, I think there's still a problem, or maybe not a problem, but a quest to understand what is the resource that we call the geology of Grand Canyon. I mean, rocks are a resource. It's not the rocks, it's the time they encode, it's the stories they have. But so to define the resource, some aspects are easy, like uranium and, you know, minerals and water. Those are resources that are finite resources that we have to protect. But a more challenging and interesting discussion is how you wrap those together into a thing you call your geology resource. People come to Grand Canyon because of its geology to a certain extent. And that's worth a continued discussion. Water quantity in the Grand Canyon is going to be impacted by decreasing snowmelt on the North Rim. That's an urgent resource question. Water quality, same way. So water quality is affected by the mixing of different waters. So there's lots of urgent resource questions, and also the sort of the overarching one of how you weave together this concept of a geology resource. So we continue to leverage the great geology of the Grand Canyon for these public outreach meetings. Next year, 2021, it was supposed to be this year, we were having the fourth decadal meeting of the community group that's trying to understand Colorado River evolution. So the first one is in the 60s with Eddie McKee, the second one 2000 at the park, third one in Flagstaff 2010. So 2020 was going to be the fourth one. We didn't do it because of COVID. We're planning to do it next year. Put it on your calendars, Earth Science Week of 2021. And we're considering the idea that we might do some virtual aspects with talks and integrate with Fossil Day. Maybe we'll have to look at Cenozoic fossils hard next year. But and then a public day, a public open day to walk on the Trail of Time with scientists. Anyway, we're cooking up ideas for 2021 that we appreciate your input on if you want to email us. And any of these papers that you saw referenced flash by on the screens, let us know. We'll try and help you find PDFs of the resources.
Those can eventually be linked in the YouTube format. So that'll be a little bit more manageable than, say, the Facebook, which is a great way to reach a broad group of people. But we will be pointing you toward the more permanent YouTube area. So thanks again, Joel, for all your work.
Of course. Yeah, no, my pleasure. Thank you for yours as well, of course. And like I said, collaborative effort between a whole bunch of really amazing people, and I'm glad it came together so well. You know, as you said, it was a little bit of a rush to actually get it put together, and but we made it work. Yeah. And so.
And thanks to the public audience for coming along. We just have had some great attendance, and we know that these are long sessions, and you can come back and watch bits and pieces of it at your heart's content.
Yeah. Yeah, no, absolutely. So yeah, I guess that's we can call it good for GeoFest 2020.
Sign off until the next effort. Let's
till next year.
Keep
thinking
about that.
It's a wrap.
Well, this has been.
We'll head into a nonconformity now until next year.
Exactly. Exactly. Yeah. But this has been an amazing experience. You know, I learned a lot. I hope everybody, you know, who's been tuning in and watching these talks and, you know, and everything learned a lot as well. So not just from the talks, but, you know, the experience of actually doing this and putting it all together. And I learned video editing. I mean, I knew a little bit, but not, uh-huh. You know, sure. Whew, yeah. So,
you know, from the chat, I'll tell you, I think out of the entire week, the most surprising thing that the public learned is that geochronologists name their mass spectrometers. That, yes. Uh-huh.
Who was there? There was Al, and there was,
Well, anyway, there's Jan a lot of names.
There was Jan and Felix.
There we go.
Jan and Felix. Hal, I especially loved Hal, and I told him that when he said about it. You know, because the fact, like I told, it was Willie, Willie Gunstner, whose instrument was called Hal 9000. The laptop that I'm actually recording this on right now is also named Hal 9000. So. It's a name I've used myself. So
okay.
Yeah. And the irony, of course, is the movie, you know, was 2001, and now 2020. Who to thunk?
Right. Yeah. Exactly. Jeez.
Time. Well, time to sign off. And
all right.
Thanks much, Joel. We'll see you soon.
Of course. Thank you.
Okay. Happy trails.